right.
Has Shaq been this weekend?
Say again, please.
I'm sorry. Has Shannon been in this weekend at all?
She's helping us set everything up, and then she's—I think she's popped in a couple of times, but I don't think she's on right now. Toby.
Check. Okay.
She does.
Hey, welcome back, everybody.
Sure.
Welcome back, everybody. Select Cranston. Since I saw your picture first, you get to lead us in the Sailor's Creed.
Sounds good. Attention to the Sailor's Creed. I, am United States Sailor. I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States of America, and I will obey the orders of those appointed over me. I represent the fighting spirit of the Navy and those who have gone before me to defend freedom and democracy around the world. I proudly serve my country's Navy combat team with honor, courage, commitment. I am committed to excellence and the fair treatment of all. Booyah.
Cool. Again, thank you for that, Select. So before we get started with the training topic for the day, we have important recognition. Is Vivian Rose on the line? All right, so while we get her ready for her hour, selectees, so it's her birthday today. She's turning 7, all right? So what I need you guys to do is who's got the best voice? Somebody raise a hand.
It's not Mike.
Cranston.
Cranston?
It's Patrick.
Nah, he already did it. Who said that? How about that? You know what? Since nobody wants to do it, we're going to do it all together. All right? So, Cranston, how we start off things. So you got to make everybody on key. All right? Hi, Vivian. Let me see. All right. Selectees, you guys ready?
Ready.
I was ready.
He's on the flight line.
Yeah, if you have an airplane with you, mute your mic.
I got him. And please keep your mic off. I got you.
All right. Select. Come on. On honor, courage, commitment. Begin.
Someone lead it. Come on.
Come on.
Hey. Honor, courage, commitment.
Thank you, everybody, for that. Now I'm going to turn the floor over to Senior Chief Jamie Covey for an introduction.
Good evening, you guys. I'm truly humbled to have the opportunity to introduce Army Chief Warrant Philip Beshear today. Although the son of the late Master Chief, Master Navy Diver Carl Beshear, our fine Navy's very first African-American diver, whose legendary story is full of inspiration and incredible pride, Chief Warrant Beshear has most certainly continued the legacy of his father. After having wrestled on scholarship at Old Dominion University, Chief Beshear joined the Navy Reserve as a jet engine mechanic in Norfolk in 1981. In 1989, he left the Navy Reserve and joined the Virginia Army National Guard, where he completed his training to become Chief Warrant as a pilot. His flying career included humanitarian support in Bolivia, post 9/11 in Bosnia, flying the UH-60 at Black Hawk, the then Operation Iraqi Freedom in 2005. He retired from Army National Guard in 2007, but in the legendary Bashir fashion, he was not done. In 2009, Chief Bashir joined the Army Reserve as a rear detachment commander while concurrently maintaining his Chinook helicopter pilot skills. And if my count is correct, that is currently 38 years of service. The list of qualifications, degrees, decorations are all very extensive. Chief Bashir is also married to Sandra Bashir, herself retired for 20 years of Army service, three daughters, and a son that is currently in ROTC. I see a third generation of greatness coming. What a complete and incredible honor that we get to hang out, learn from the amazing Chief Warrant. So the floor is yours, sir.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir, we can.
Let me tell you something. I spent 8 years in the Navy Reserve before I went over to the dark side, but I will tell you now, because none of my Army buddies are here, had I not joined the Navy Reserves, I wouldn't be the person I am today. So I thank the Navy for everything they did. To include the 18 years of military duty I did under my dad's tutelage, coming up in that household. That was something else. I tell you what, I've been around the Navy my whole life, even though I wear this Army uniform, and I can't start to even describe the joy I get from being around Navy people. I grew up being around Navy people, and at 58 years old, still in the Army Reserves, I'm still around Navy people, and I love it. I just enjoy everything that you guys bring to the table. And there is no ceremony, no tradition in military history like the tradition of a person going from E6 enlisted to Navy chief. See, a lot of people in the military go to E7, but in the Navy, you go from E6 to Navy chief. And I'm gonna tell you, there's no other service that does it like you guys. I'm so proud of the tradition. And I tell you what, for you selectees, my hat's off to you. There's no other rank in the service like E7 when you become the chief in the Navy. That's quite an accomplishment. And my hat's off to you. And I even feel proud being called chief, even though I'm a warrant officer. I feel proud being called chief because I remember seeing my dad and the legacy that he left being called chief all the time. And I'm proud of that. And I'm so proud of you guys. And I'm so thankful that you guys are here. A lot of times I get asked about my dad, and a lot of people will just say, well, yeah, your dad was this, he was that. But I will tell you the five things that I always say that he went through to become the person he was. And you guys know the story. He had to deal with racism. He had to deal with bigotry. That's one thing. But remember where my father came from, that poor sharecropper family farm in Kentucky. So he dealt with a lot of illiteracy. He was 17 years old with an eighth grade education when he joined the military back in 1948. He came from a poor family, so he was under the social restraint of being a poor kid from poverty joining the military. Later on in my dad's career, and you guys know the story, he lost the left part of his, the left bottom part of his leg during that incident in 1966. And I'm not ashamed to tell you, because my father wasn't perfect, there's only one perfect person that's ever walked this earth. But before my dad retired, he actually submitted himself to the Navy Alcohol Substance Abuse course so that he could try to get that monkey off his back and retire with honors in 1979. Now, you know, this country has produced many great people. George Washington, Abraham Lincoln, Martin Luther King. And I can't even start to name the great women. But I just want to put this in perspective. Think about the five things that my father endured and still made a name for himself to be a worldwide Navy celebrity. He had to go through and overcome racism, poverty, illiteracy, physical disability, and substance abuse with his alcohol problem. I can't think of a famous person today that had to undergo those five hurdles and still make a name for himself. George Washington was a white aristocrat, plenty of money, high education. Abraham Lincoln, great education, and he didn't have to go through racism. Martin Luther King, yes, he had to go through some racism, but he was highly educated, come from a middle-class family. I'm not trying to say that my father was all that, but I'm just trying to put in perspective the five things that he overcame and still, through the help of the Navy and with the Navy backing him, look at the kind of person that he became. To me, that makes his story even more, much more appealing because of the things that he had to overcome just to be the person that he was. And just like you Navy chiefs that are crossing over now, I'm telling you, my father had to overcome those hurdles. You had to overcome hurdles yourself. I don't know what they are. I don't know any of you personally, but I'm sure you didn't get here with a silver spoon in your mouth. I don't think there's not a select out there that said, oh, I had it easy. I was just given this Navy chief rank and I'm going forward with it. None of you guys had that. You all had to overcome something. And I'm proud of the fact that whatever it is in your personal life or in your professional life, maybe you got in trouble in the past. Maybe you've had some writers in the Navy that weren't very good. But guess what? You were selected to become chief now, and now you're crossing over into one of the greatest ranks, one of the greatest fraternities in the military, especially in the Navy, to become a chief, from going from chief select to becoming a chief. I can't explain, and I can't even put into words how proud I am. Like I said, to be part of this just means a lot to me. And the fact that I get invited year after year to come and be with you guys, and people ask me to write charges in their books. And you know, to me, that just, through me, I'm able to keep my dad's legacy going because you guys love my dad. And of course, I love my dad, but to be able to be with the Navy now and continuing on with this legacy and continuing on with this fellowship with the Navy that I've been able to enjoy, just my hat's off to it. I just love it. And I tell you what, the fact that you love and honor my dad makes the pain of not having him around that much easier, because it's not a day that goes by I don't think about my mom or my dad. But now that I'm here with my Navy buddies, it just makes that pain a little bit less, because I know you guys love him too, and we're able to celebrate his legacy and push these next selectees into the rank of being E7 chiefs in the Navy. I'm getting kind of choked up now, getting kind of lost for words, but I just want you guys to know I really do honor this. I was listening to the Admiral earlier, and of course he gave you all the doctrine, he gave you all the high level stuff that of course the admirals give, because my dad always told me that, you know, he wasn't a general officer or a politician, so he doesn't give speeches. No disrespect to the Admiral, but he's a general officer, so those guys give speeches. My dad didn't believe in that. He always believed in speaking from the heart, and that's what I'm trying to do now, is just speak from the heart, giving you guys the honor and respect that you deserve, and my hat's off to you. With that, are there any questions, anything I can add or anything I can do for you guys tonight, other than the fact that I am so proud of you guys, and I'm glad to be here with you? Any selectees have anything?
I have a question for you. I noticed that we received charges from you, which we truly appreciate, but can you tell us more about the foundation?
Oh, okay. Well, let me tell you, when my father passed away in 2006, there were a lot of people, not just Navy folks, but there was a lot of people that just started sending me money. Well, I didn't know what to do with that money, and a cousin of mine in Alabama said, Philip, why don't you start a foundation and honor your dad? And you can just give the money away to other charities in his name. So I did the paperwork. The IRS, you know, passed my paperwork through to be a nonprofit 501c3 charity. And the money that I collect on my dad, I just give it away to the VA hospitals in my father's name. Now, we're not a multi-million-dollar foundation. And I think right now, to be honest with you, there's maybe $22,000 in the account. But from time to time, I take $1,000 chunks and I give it to the VA hospital in my dad's name, to various VA hospitals throughout the country. There's no overhead. There's nothing special. A chief buddy of mine in Little Creek said, hey, Philip, to help with your foundation, why don't we come up with a coin, and you can kind of like give those away with donations, and you can keep the foundation sponsored and going with that. So I did that. So to answer your question, the foundation is nothing more than just me writing some checks to the different VA hospitals in my father's name for as long as that money lasts, because I don't get a dime of it. It all goes back out the doors, and that's what I plan on doing. There's about 17 VA hospitals around the country that I've donated to, and I'm just going to keep marking them off the list giving $1,000 checks in my dad's name. And that's the crux of the whole foundation. For as long as it lasts, that's what I'm going to do with it. But it's a way to put a web page together and keep all the attributes and the honors that are given to my dad. And you guys already know about the ship. You already know about the watches. I don't know if you ever, many of you know about the Swiss company that did some luxury watches in honor of my dad. And of course, they donate to the foundation. And basically, that's it. Did that answer your question?
Yes, it did. Thank you so much. And I'm Chief Select Taylor, so I really appreciate it. And I appreciate you providing the charge that you did. So thank you. Oh,
thank you. Appreciate that. Anytime. Anyone else?
Master Chief, Chief Wigger. I mean, Warren.
That's okay.
Like father, like son.
Okay.
Sir, you said you, you with your charity, people send money and you send coins. If you could get to Michelle your address and I can email you, we can maybe do something for you. I'm with the Chief's exhibit on the battleship New Jersey.
Sure, that's fine. I'm with that. I'm okay with that. That's fine. Like I said, it's nothing. It's not like one of these major, you know, foundations that you see out here in the world that are generating millions of dollars, like the Clinton Foundation or nothing like that. But like I said, I just donate chunks of money to the VA hospital. It's not so much. I wish I could fund scholarships and everything else to my father's name, but it's not like that. But every little bit counts when it comes to our VA hospitals. So I think the VA is a great cause.
Yeah, if you can pass on your contact information, we appreciate it, sir.
Okay, certainly will. Now, I will tell you, my father had a great sense of humor, and the movie really doesn't show that. When I was about 15 years old, I was remember being in the front room of the house that we lived in Portsmouth, Virginia, and I'm 6'4". My dad was only 5'9", and I'm not trying to get on anybody who's 5'9", but to me, that's kind of short. So I remember standing there talking to my dad. I think my mom was back in the back washing dishes or something in the kitchen. And I asked my dad, I said, Dad, because at 15 years old, I was already close to 6 feet. And I looked down at him. I said, Dad, how come I'm so tall and you're so short? And just like a good old Master Chief, he gave me that look of, oh, okay, now I got to deal with a little smart Alex son. He looked up at me and said, Son, I was out to sea before you came along. So you better go ask your mother how you get your height from. He had his way of putting me in my place. And then when I became a pilot, he said, you know, I used to joke with him and said, Dad, I scored higher on the ASVAB test. I passed with a higher score. I go up, not down. And he said, Son, don't give me that bull. Just remember this. There'll always be divers looking for pilots. There'll never be a pilot looking for a diver. So he had plenty of ways to put me in my place. And I tell you, I really enjoy that. And every chance I get, because I live in the Richmond area in Virginia, every chance I get, I hightail it down to that Carver Shear Center in Little Creek just to be around some of the people that still remember him and the new people that are coming in. And since that's close to home down there in Virginia Beach, I always go down there and spend time and do as much as I can. I just wish the ship was based out of Norfolk like its sister ships instead of being based out of San Diego. The USNS Carver Shear is out of San Diego. I think, man, what a crime when they know his son lives right here in Virginia. But, again, like I said, I love being around the Navy, and I really appreciate you guys having me around. And Leo, I am so glad that I'm not the oldest guy on this call, so thank you for being there.
We tend to get infinitely closer in age, not further apart.
Well, I'm glad you're there, because I'm not the only guy that can call old man on this call right now. But I'm still in. Like I said, 38 years. I just got promoted to CW5, and my plan is to retire when I turn 60. So July of 22 is when I turn 60, and I think I'll definitely be hanging the uniform up then. So all you guys in the Navy Reserves, match me. Stay in for about 40 years, and then call it quits. I'll tell you what, the benefits are great.
But it's nice getting that check every month once you're retired.
Got you. I got you. I can't wait. Well, at 58, I'll be getting it soon. I can see that light in the tunnel.
Yes, sir.
Hey, Philip, it's Gina. So when I first spoke to you a couple years back, you told me a really significant story about how your dad shielded you and your siblings from everything that he was going through. Like when he was going through it, he would come home and he would still be dad. Can you talk to the Selects a little bit about how he did that for you?
Oh, yes, yes. You know, there was a lot that my father had to go through, and you guys know the story, and you, of course you realize how the country was back in the day. But let me tell you something, growing up in our household, going to the Navy bases, I never got exposed to that. Everybody was one big family. I think that's one benefit that we have being in the military is that that's not tolerated. Any kind of segregation or racism isn't tolerated, and I love the military for that. You know, every day my father would come home and he was just dad. It was like there was no pressure, or he didn't bring the pressures of what he was going through on his job home. I think really the only thing that did affect him because of everything that he went through, and like I said, he wasn't a perfect man, but I think the drinking was escalated a lot because of what he was going through. But he took that upon himself. He never came home or and shared any of the racism or the hard times that he was going through at the job. He just kept us oblivious to us. All this stuff, he just kept us oblivious. I never even knew that there was a difference between white and black people when it came to race, not until I got close to being 17, 18 years old in high school. My whole time growing up, we all got together, we all were one family. Race was never an issue that I saw. But I tell you, I really appreciate my dad for keeping us in that kind of generic world where color wasn't a factor, because I just think it made my childhood coming up a lot better, because I didn't have any pressure on me for being who I was or what I looked like. So I really do appreciate my dad for that. He kept a lot of that to himself, and he didn't expose us to it. And I really appreciate that. I think if more people did that, the world would be a lot better. And think about what he did. You know, the Civil Disability Act didn't come out until 1990, but my father went through what he went through in 1966, proving the fact that a handicapped person could still be viable in the military. Well, think about it, 1966, to the year 1992 when the Civil Disability Act came, it took the government and the military that long to realize, hey, just because a person's handicapped doesn't mean that they're useless. So my dad helped this country in a lot of ways by doing what he did, showing everybody in the world that no matter where you come from, no matter what shortcomings you may have, you can still add to this country and be a viable citizen in it. The only thing that my father didn't do was increase the opportunities for women. But I do think the fact that he educated people on opening their minds, it made careers for women a lot better. So even though he wasn't a woman, I really think he helped women across the board too, because what he did, he exposed the culture to be more inclusive. So that was a good thing on him.
Sir, this she's like low. I feel like you probably lived with a legacy your whole life. You were in the shadow of just a great man, and that's great. And then you came out, and you made the name your own and yourself. So now I'm sitting here as a Chief Select. I'm about to dive into a community where there's a huge amount of legacy. What advice could you give me as a soon-to-be Chief Petty Officer on how to not only just embrace a legacy, but make it your own?
Well, you know, something that the Master Chief said earlier, and he was talking about excellence, you know, just try to excel and be excellent at your job. Excellence doesn't mean perfect, because none of us are going to be perfect. We're all still going to make mistakes regardless what rank you are. But what I would suggest to you is to just strive for excellence. Just be the person you are and bring what you have, your strengths, to the Chief's Mess to add to the other strengths that are already there. Let me tell you something. There's no individual when it comes to the Chief's Mess. You've got that group of cohort chiefs together to where all your knowledge is pulled together to make the heavy decisions that you have to make. That's what you guys are there for, lean on each other. You know, in the warrant officer branch, in the Army, I've got other buddies that I deal with, and just because I'm a CW5 doesn't mean I know it all. But I will tell you this, it means that when I don't know something, to say I don't know, but I'm gonna get the answer for you right away. That's what you need to do. Just embrace it and say, hey, if I don't know the answer right now, let me tell you something. I'm going to strive to get it to you as soon as possible. Never be scared to say I don't know something, but always strive to get that answer to that person who's asking for advice as soon as possible. Just strive for excellence. That's all I can ask you to be. Just strive to be excellent.
Awesome. Thank you so much, sir.
No sweat.
Sir, this is Chief Select LaBrèche. I wondered if I could just ask you if you could talk a little bit about your decision to move from the Navy Reserve to the Army side, to the dark side, as you said. You know, I mean, what was that about? Was that an attempt to sort of strike out on your own, you know, and make your own legacy?
No, actually, I didn't mind. I loved being in the Navy, but in the Navy, I was a helicopter crewman. And because I messed around and didn't get my degree on time, I couldn't apply for Navy flight school. But the Army has that program where you can become a warrant officer and go to flight school and continue a flying career. So when that opportunity was there, since I didn't have a degree, I jumped right on it, went to flight school, and the rest is history. So it wasn't me trying to break away from the Navy. I would have flown in the Navy if they had given me the chance. But I didn't do my due diligence as a young kid and get my degree out of the way so I could apply for Navy flight school. I would have been in the Navy as a pilot. I didn't want to be a diver because, man, what kind of shadow would I have been in then? I told you I got to go up, not down. But that was the only reason I broke away, was the opportunity was there for me to go to flight school.
Understood. Thank you, sir. It's an honor for you to be here.
Oh, thank you. Appreciate it.
I think we had a hand up by Joshua Lowe. Does your have a question?
Actually, I got mine already. I think it's just a delay. My hand's not down yet.
Yeah, well, oh, gotcha.
I have my hand up. Chief Select Drohan from Knoxport Dix, New Jersey. Sir, I'm also I'm an air crewman, and I used to fly in helicopters as well as a crew chief. Are you still currently flying now as a CW-05 in the Army?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
In fact, I'm still getting flight pay, even though I got promoted, and right now I'm a command chief warrant officer of a training division. I made my gates because I flew for over 18 years, so I'm still getting my flight pay per month, but I'm still a rated qualified helicopter pilot. I'm in this desk job right now, but every year I still have to maintain my flight physical. If someone were to jump off right now, guys, I'd be in a cockpit wherever I need to be. But right now I am right at the desk because I'm in a training division right now as the command chief warrant officer. And I'm so proud to be a command chief warrant officer because I remember my dad being a command master chief. And man, it feels like, wow, my dad was a command master chief. I've been blessed to become a command chief warrant officer. So I don't know what the heck my son's going to do. He's going to have to be a freaking admiral or something. I don't know, but the sky's the limit for him. But I know the progression is there.
Awesome. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
I will tell you this. Who are the HMs out there?
Booyah.
Okay. Let me tell you, my father was actually pronounced dead 3 times during that incident off the coast of Spain when he had his leg mangled up. He didn't finally get his leg amputated until they got him back to the States. But 3 times during that trip from the coast of Spain in the water to being flown to Tarragona, Spain, and then from Spain to Germany, and then from Germany back to the States, during that course of action, he was actually pronounced dead 3 times. The first time he was pronounced dead, that corpsman took one more check and said, oh my God, he's not dead yet. So they were going to roll my dad's body into the refrigerator with the hamburgers and hot dogs because there's no morgue on the ship. He was actually getting to roll his body into the cooler, and that corpsman took one more check and said, oh my God, he's not dead yet. So that corpsman saved my dad's life from going into that cooler when he wasn't really quite dead yet. But 2 other times along that trip, his heartbeat pretty much stopped with the loss of blood, and they pronounced him dead 2 other times. So 3 times, I don't know anybody who survived death 3 times and lived to tell about it, but my dad sure did.
Hooyah, Corman. Sir, I actually had the pleasure of working with a surgeon that operated on your father in the hospital. He was Captain Snyder, really good-to-go guy from Boston, Massachusetts. So with the Seabees, I had a chance to work with him. So it's pretty cool to see how small the world really is, and it's a real pleasure to have you on board with us. Thank you very much.
Yes. Can I share a story with you guys? Do I have time?
Go for it.
You do.
Okay. You know, they talk about my dad's legacy, and I feel in a way I live the same legacy. Back in 2014, I went in for a flight physical, and I was pronounced with a irregular heartbeat. I was actually in atrial fibrillation, which means irregular heartbeat. And, the Army ended my flight career for about a year. There was all kinds of studies that they were going to do and all kinds of tests. But what the Army finally did, since I was at Fort Eustis, Virginia, they sent me over to the Naval Hospital to get checked out. A month after I was diagnosed with atrial fibrillation, I got in contact with the Commander Spooner, who's a heart specialist at the Naval Hospital in Portsmouth. This Dr. Spooner, when I met him, said, "Hey, you're Brashear. I worked on your dad when before he passed away in 2006. And my first thought was, wait, if you worked on my dad, he passed away. What are you going to do for me? But he was the heart specialist for my dad during that time. So he said, "Brashear, you're in good shape. I think I'm going to put you in for a procedure and see if you can come back and get your flight career back." So what he did, a month after I was diagnosed, I had to go through blood thinners for about 6 weeks. Dr. Spooner, Michael Spooner, gave me what they call a cardioversion 3 months after I was diagnosed with atrial fibrillation. Now, cardioversion is what I call the Frankenstein procedure. They put a metal plate on my chest and a metal plate on my back, put me to sleep, and zap me. It's like a jump start for the heart. Well, guess what? The cardioversion worked, and my heart was put back in rhythm. So for 9 months, I fought my way back dealing with the folks at Fort Rucker, which is the home for Army Aviation, going through their medical staff. And get just like my father, military medicine got me squared away. And a year later, I got my flight status back. So, you know, I talk about my dad and the things he went through with his leg. You know, modern medicine was going to kick me out of the cockpit, but military modern medicine, got me back in the fight, and I'm still flying today. So I kind of feel like I lived the same life my dad did with something that was going to stop me from my job. But guess what? Military medicine got me back in the fight. So my hat's off to the corpsmen and all you medical folks out there. And I feel like, just like my dad, I didn't want doctors to tell me my flight career was over. I didn't want anybody to say, "Oh, you're done." But they put me back in, and they got me squared away, back in the fight. So that's my story when it comes to reliving the same kind of legacy my dad had to go through.
The cool part is there's Navy medicine that got you back.
Navy medicine, that's right. That's right. But I wouldn't suggest that Frankenstein zap test to anybody, because when I woke up, I was pretty burned on my chest. They put a pretty good zap in you.
It's fun doing it.
Oh, you've done it?
Yes. I'm also a paramedic.
Oh, okay.
And a former.
Oh, okay. So you know about cardioversion.
It's fun.
Okay, yeah. Well, it wasn't cool getting it. I'm sure it was probably cool giving it. But it's all good, guys. I'm going to tell you, well, that's my story. But, you know, I talk about my dad and the things that he went through. And it seems like history repeated itself in my case. Again, my hat's off to the Navy. Any other questions? Are we good?
Come on, Selexia. You got to have another question out there.
Hey, Warren, I'll jump in real quick and ask you a question since you are aviation and it is the Navy. Have you ever had the pleasure of landing on a Navy vessel?
Yes, I have. Many times. When I was in the Army National Guard, I got to fly my Black Hawk off the coast of Virginia in the Chesapeake Bay on a couple of helo carriers. My dream was to stay in long enough to land a helicopter on the USNS Carl Brashear. But again, the Navy screwed me over by making that a San Diego-based ship instead of Norfolk. I could have pulled it if it was in Norfolk, but I can't pull justifying flying a helicopter to the West Coast just to land on my dad's ship. So I love the Navy, but they screwed me over on that one.
You still actually go and take trainers, go up and get your flight time, keep current?
Yes, sir. I still do the simulators and everything, stay current. But, and like I said, if something were to happen today, I'd be right back in the cockpit, because, you know, the Army loves its warned helicopter pilots, and we're the first ones to go anywhere. When I was in Iraq, I was flying around at TQ and Al Asad in 2006 and 7. Well, my dad passed away in July 2006. I came home for 30 days and got my dad's stuff all squared away. The minute I got back to Al Asad, the Navy CB detachment there pulled me in, and they talked to my commander. And for 2 weeks, I lived and slept and just hung out with the CBs with permission from my commander, just to hang out and get my mind back together before going back to my Iraq duties. So I tell you what, that CB unit that was there really looked out for me. And I really, like I said, again, the Navy's jumping in to take care of one of its own. And I was Army. All the Army guys like, how can you hang out with the Navy guys? Well, when I was in Iraq, the Seabees took care of me. And I tell you what, there's so many stories I could tell you like that, man. But after my father's passing, the Navy again jumped in and took care of one of its own, me. So I really do have my hats off and my heart's in love with the Navy. Even though I wear this Army uniform. Just don't tell my Army buddies that, but I think they know.
CNC Jamie Covey here, since genuines are asking questions. I just want to know, is there an anchor somewhere hidden in that uniform?
I was going to ask the same question. If you have your dad, one of your dad's anchors under your collar or under your pocket.
You know what? To be honest with you, I really don't. But you just gave me a great idea. You just gave me a great idea to put a Mass Chief anchor on the bottom of this lapel. You just gave me a great idea, and I think I should do that. Thank you so much.
Hey, Ms. sir, that's long Jamie? Overdue. Yes. A big giant heart and a great legacy. There ought to be an anchor somewhere in that uniform, sir.
You got that right. You got that right. You just gave me a great idea. Look, for the 18 months I got left before I turn 60, I'm going to do that. Make sure I put me a Mass Chief anchor right on the bottom of this lapel.
Do you have one there with you now?
I sure do.
Do it now. Let them see it.
Oh my gosh. I'd have to go into my safe and pull up all my dad's stuff, but I do. I'll do that. I promise you I'll do that. Well, you guys see my room. It's all about my dad. I don't know if you guys can see all this. And I got my Navy anchor on the wall over there, so I'm representing.
And you see my I have a question. Have you ever considered writing a book about your story? And if not, is that something you would consider doing maybe in retirement?
I think in retirement, yeah, I'll have plenty of time to do that in retirement. That'll give me plenty to do. And see where this foundation goes. But I will tell you, especially with this Swiss company doing these watches, I don't know how far that's going to go, but they plan on doing another one and we'll see what happens with that. But writing a book in my retirement sounds like a great idea.
Outstanding.
Sir, this is Senior Chief Williams. I just had a quick question. As the son of a Master Chief, can you think of a time when maybe you were younger as a teenager that you weren't quite motivated, in which case your father was able to motivate you? And you, as a parent, I'd be interested to hear that.
Well, I will tell you that when I was coming up in high school, my dad wanted to send me to the Naval Academy, and I wasn't really interested in the military until I finally got out of high school and I joined the military. You know, it's tough with any father-son relationship coming up through those teenage years. I don't know if, I guess sometimes you just go through those struggles of that testosterone, you know, revving up in me as a teenager, and that testosterone that my dad had to where you had two bulls fighting. Of course, I was going to be on the losing end of that fight anyway, regardless of whatever happened, but there wasn't too much that my dad could do because it was just conflict. I mean, he tried to motivate us. Like, you know, I listened to everything he said, but I think, you know, just coming up with just regular father-son stuff and me filling my oats and growing a few hairs here and there, you just normally have that father-son kind of battle. It's hard to describe now, but I tell you, from the time I joined the military in 1981, up to now, he has definitely been a motivational force in my life. But I got to tell you, growing up was hard because my dad was hard. So that's all I can say. It was just hard. You know, he was strict. There's a movie that was out about a Marine Corps dad and his son, and I can't remember the name of it, but I remember Rob Duvall was the Marine Corps dad. And there was always conflicts with his son because the Marine Corps dad was so tough. And I kind of relate to that movie. I can't think of the name of it right now, but if you can imagine a hardcore Navy Master Chief diver in a household with some irresponsible, immature teenage sons, there was a lot of mixing going on. So I'll just leave it at that.
Roger that. Thank you very much.
Yes.
Hey, sir. This is Chief Jit. Thank you. Thank you so much for being here and giving us the guidance you have given us today. Just great stories. We love to hear them. We would like to proceed to the next event, and I wanted to ask you if you'd like to remain with us, so that way you can see some of the stuff we could do. You know, because the next portion of the event is actually our PT side of the house, I think you're gonna like some of the videos. I think we incorporated some of the stuff you guys do in the Army in there.
So, okay.
So without further ado, Senior Ziegler.
All right, hey, I'm Senior Chief Rob Ziegler. I'm the Command Senior Chief for NOSC St. Louis, and it's an honor to be here. I want to kick off the PT Heritage portion of the USS New Jersey training. I think that we talked a little bit in the beginning about what the purpose of this event was. It's a direct correlation with your physical capabilities, your ability to train, and your professionalism as a leader in the United States Navy. All you need to do is to take a look at your fit rep, and you're going to be able to see how you can directly connect your lethality to your physical fitness and for us to go out there and be able to win wars. So, and then we're also taking that and we're driving it together with a sense of heritage with what we're doing here. And I'm looking forward to the creativity that you've been able to utilize or come together with as a team to show how to use naval history and demonstrate who we are as a service by taking that and leveraging that not only to each other, but then carry that on to your sailors. So that's what I've got for the introduction piece of that. I'll turn it back over to you, Chief Jit, and let's see what we've got here in the queue.
Okay, so the next video we have queued up here is it's actually what you would have been experiencing if we were doing not a virtual event, more of an in-person event. So Chief, could we play that video, please?
Load now. Why can I not grab control? Oh, we need plan B. I can't grab control.
Okay. At this point, since I guess we can't have control. So team one, go ahead and present your video.
Trying to pull it up right now.
If you have sound, it's not playing.
It's not playing.
You have to click the share sound when you share before you share screen.
You'll have to stop sharing and then reshare.
All right. Sorry, one second here.
There you go.
Okay, boat team one. That was a good looking video. Let's see what boat team two has in store for us.
Just 1 minute to pull it up. Tradition. Tells of a chime that changed the world on July 8, 1776, with the Liberty Bell ringing out from the Tower of Independence Hall, summoning the citizens of Philadelphia to hear the first public reading of the Declaration of Independence by Colonel John Nixon. Although the Liberty Bell has cracked, the Chief Selects from Boat Team 2 will never crack. We keep our mind, body, and soul strong to the core through physical fitness. Chief Select Shell completed 50 push-ups for the 50-year anniversary. The Pennsylvania Assembly had the Liberty Bell made in 1751 to mark the 50-year anniversary of William Penn's 1701 Charter of Privileges, which served as Pennsylvania's original constitution. Chief Select Smith completed 1,835 sit-ups so far this season for the year the bell was referred to as the Liberty Bell in 1835. Chief Select Francois performed jumping jacks for 3 minutes, symbolizing the lip to the crown of the Liberty Bell, which is 3 feet high. Chief Select Usher completed 13 four-count squats. On every 4th of July at 2 p.m. Eastern Time, children who are descendants of Declaration signers symbolically tap the Liberty Bell 13 times, while bells across the nation also ring 13 times in honor of the patriots from the original 13 states. Chief Select Coble completed 7 four-count lunges to represent the 7th day of June, 1753, when the Liberty Bell was hung from Independence Hall. Chief Select Ainsley ran 8 miles this week, roughly the same distance from the USS New Jersey to the Liberty Bell and back. Chief Select Cranston completed 40 knee blocks. 40 drill bit marks can be seen in the crack on the Liberty Bell. In 1846, it was decided that the bell should be repaired prior to George Washington's birthday. Metal workers used a technique called stop drilling to widen the thin crack to prevent its further spread. If you look carefully at the crack, you can see 40 drill bit marks or more. Unfortunately, the repair was ultimately unsuccessful and the bell was silenced permanently. This concludes Boat Team 2's PT Heritage presentation.
Thank you, Boat Team 2. On to you, Boat Team 3.
Are you able to see the PowerPoint?
Yes.
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Team 3 will be talking about the Independence Hall and sharing pictures from our PT during this season. So in 1776, the Second Continental Congress signed the Declaration of Independence, leading to the building that you can see here being dubbed as the Independence Hall. Here is a picture of myself, Chief Select Spies, hiking the East Fortuna Trails. Every Saturday, I am tasked with hiking and picking up trash if I see any trash on the trail as well.
11 years later, delegates of the Constitutional Convention created and signed the United States Constitution in the Independence Hall. This is a photo of myself, ISC Lauren Carey, doing a push-up challenge with a genuine chief earlier this morning during season training.
President Lincoln's body was held in state on 22 April 1865 in the assembly room within Independence Hall. Here's a picture of me doing some push-ups at NOSC Atlanta today.
Originally known as the Pennsylvania State House, Independence Hall was a symbol of the nation to come. At the time of its construction, it was the most ambitious public building in the 13 colonies. There you see myself, LSE Select Tamika Taylor, and I am loving Jacksonville, Florida right now, and I'm on my spin bike doing a spin class.
The Independence Hall is by every estimate the birthplace of the United States. The hall was honored by being placed on the back of the $100 bill. And myself, ITC Select Jonathan Courtney, and HMC Select Yadinia Rodriguez, who were highly motivated that we've done 24-count squats as part of a squat challenge.
It is folklore that Ben Franklin would occasionally trip other delegates from his aisle seat. Here's a picture of myself practicing this morning at NAS NYC.
Now that will do it for both teams three, today's training. So we say thank you very much for participating. Navy Chief, Navy Pride.
Thank you, both team three. Both team four, over to you.
All right, good evening. I'm HTC Select Gregory Laup, and it's boat team four, Team Hailstorm.
And Franklin.
Oh, shoot. I clicked on the wrong darn thing. I apologize. 1 second. This is what happens when you put an HT in charge of anything having to do with technology. All right, let's try that again. I am still HTC Select Gregory Laup, and this is boat team four. All right, we have Chief Select Dixon demonstrating the upright row on his machine. As we all know, the row is a new PRT alternative for us this year, and that is Select Dixon doing an outstanding job. All right, this is me. This is HTC Select Gregory Laup showing off his Rombod and his sweet CPL Select T shirt and glow belt as I contemplate doing my recorded PT session here for the Genuines in St. Louis. This is Chief Select Kanzler. He is demonstrating a popper plank, which is also new for our PRT this season. This is Chief Select Burns. Chief Select Burns is motivating us by doing push-ups this morning. Look at that great form. All right, this is for part of our PT for our season. We're required to do a minimum 2 mile run or 30 minutes of cardio. This is me tracking my run from November. As you can see, I'm setting a blistering pace of 9 minutes and 30 seconds. I'm happy to report I survived this. We do three PT sessions a week. We have to upload that in the teams and get ridiculed by the genuines, I'm sure. This is a little brief synopsis of what one of our PT plans looks like that we record. Every lesson is a different PT lead. It's good training. Something you don't do every day as a Navy reservist. All right, for our heritage, during the run, we would run past, we would be running past the Independence Seaport Museum, and we would be able to observe the two Navy vessels you see here. First, we have the cruiser USS Olympia. It was launched in 1892. She was commissioned by the United States Navy for the first time in February 1885, and at the time she was a state-of-the-art man of war. She rose to fame as Commodore, later Admiral, George Dewey's flagship during the Battle of Manila Bay, May 1st, 1898. Her final active service was the transportation of the American unknown soldier of World War I from France to the United States in 1921. Over Olympia's 27 years of service, she saw two wars and the administrations of six presidents. Thousands of Americans served aboard as commissioned officers and enlisted sailors. Olympia's design, out of a period known as the New Steel Navy, an era of American ships designed from late 1880s through early 1900s. I brought that up because I really think I really think she's a beautiful ship. I know it's not practical to have that design, but for me, she's just got great lines. All right, the second Navy vessel you'll see tied up is the submarine Vicuna. The submarine Vicuna is a Bailo class submarine launched on January 30th, 1944 from Groton, Connecticut. She was commissioned on May 27th, 1944, and sent immediately to the Pacific Ocean, where she engaged the naval forces of Imperial Japan during World War II. Vicuna completed five wartime patrols, sinking 3.5 ships and earning 4 combat stars for her service. In 1951, she underwent modernization. Vicuna was refitted with a Guppy 1 Alpha modification that included streamlined hull, fairwater sail, upgraded batteries, and snorkel system. Vicuna is the only Guppy 1 Alpha type submarine remaining anywhere in the world. Vicuna was finally decommissioned on November 7th, 1969, after 25 years of service. She was made a museum in July 1976. Vicuna became part of the collection at Independence Seaport Museum at that time. And that concludes our presentation. Thank you.
All right, boat team five.
All right, good evening. This is YNC Select McKenzie representing for team high five. Give me 1 second.
All right, both Team 5, I think you're having technical difficulties. So for now, we're going to move on to the next video.
Chief, let me try. I'm the backup.
Okay.
Chief Select Lock here. Let me take share my screen real quick.
Thanks.
You got it.
Not to add any pressure, but I have to do at least once this event. Hurry up.
All right, team, let me figure this out. Vote Team 5 to be continued.
All right, hey, Chief, you want to play the video we have queued up for them?
All right, let's give this a try here.
He was an Army contracting officer.
Alright. Share. Movie. Where's my movie?
Hurry up.
Let's go, turn two.
Save us, Sarah.
I can do it if you need me to. Are you calling Mercy?
Yeah, do it.
Okay. Let me know when you can see it.
Yep, it's good to go.
Okay.
2, 3, 4, 8.
1, 2, 3, 4, 8.
4, 8.
1, 2, 3, 4, 8.
Here we go. On the move.
On the move.
In the groove.
In the groove.
In the groove.
In the groove.
Here we go. All the way.
All the way.
Every day.
Every day. Rock steady.
Roll me ready.
Rock.
All night long, we're gonna roll.
Roll.
To break of dawn, we're gonna swing it. You wanna go home, we're gonna shake it. In the twilight zone, we're gonna rock.
Roll.
Get.
Stay.
Ready.
So, selectees, that would have been something you would have been able to experience if we had done a in-person Big J. And if you noticed, that wasn't just the Chief Selects that were in there. There were some Air Force E-7s there in there that voluntarily decided to participate. So, as usual, this is a highly coveted event that's open to all branches if they go through the proper channels and request participation. The next video we have is what the CPOs have done so far to essentially stay fit and be ready to fight. So, Sarah, we're ready for the next video.
Got it.
Team 5 is ready to present too.
It's talking because I have hold.
Can you guys see it?
Not yet.
Negative, Ghost Rider.
And I'm just going to throw out that there's a special guest appearance in this video by Force Master Chief Coates. See if you can find him.
Brian, Brandon, while we're doing this, if you wouldn't mind just doing a quick intro.
Sure. Yeah. Thanks, Alvin. Yeah, this video I just collected randomly from a number of Genuines, just reached out to them to see, you know, what are you guys doing to stay fit in this COVID time? And you'll see a good mix of stuff. I think the important thing to take away is that, you know, you got to stay fit. You got to figure out a way to, you know, get your sweat on, you know, move. And just do things. You can mix it up. You can do fun stuff. You can do, you can walk the dog, you know, but you got to get in your stuff to prepare you for the PT too. There's a great program out there. Some of you might have seen it, the 30-day plank challenge, and that'll get you to 3 minutes. There's a bunch of good regimens on YouTube that can get you going. So, you know, we got to lead from the front as Genuine Chiefs, and part of that is being fit and showing the way. So let's take a look at what some of our brothers and sisters are doing.
You can see the video now, right?
Yes.
Yep.
Perfect.
You can't break my body down.
You can't break my body down.
Oh, you can't break my body down.
Oh, no, you can't break my body down.
You gotta work your body, body. Work your body, body.
Work your body, body. Work your body, body.
Move your body, body. Move your body, body.
Move your body, body. Move your body, body.
Make your body sweat. Make your body sweat.
Make your body sweat. Make your body sweat.
Feel your body, body. Feel your body, body.
Feel your body, body. Feel your body, body.
You can't break my body down.
You can't break my body down.
Oh, you can't break my body down.
Oh, no, you can't break my body down.
You gotta work your body, body. Work your body, body.
Work your body, body. Work your body, body.
Move your body, body. Move your body, body.
Move your body, body. Move your body, body.
Make your body sweat. Make your body sweat.
Make your body sweat. Make your body sweat.
Feel your body, body. Feel your body, body.
Feel your body, body. Feel your body, body.
Here we go.
Here we go.
Here we go.
Here we go.
Sound off.
Sound off.
Sound if we.
Sound if we.
Number one.
Number one.
With the run.
With the run.
Having fun.
Having fun.
With the run.
With the run.
What are you doing, Chiefs?
Push-ups
for freedom.
For freedom.
Woo! What are you doing, senior?
You can't break my body down.
Oh, no, you can't break my body down.
You gotta work your body, body. Work your body, body.
Work your body, body. Work your body, body.
Move your body, body. Move your body, body.
Move your body, body. Move your body, body.
Make your body sweat. Make your body sweat.
Alright, face is up. We don't look at the decks, do we?
Nope.
Nope. We're about 3 minutes. Yeah?
I don't know.
Maybe. Alright, who runs it, girls?
Chiefs!
Who runs it, Elena? Say it.
Alright, we're doing this is how we kept in shape, me and my son during COVID. I'm 40 now. It's getting pretty tired. He started doing more than me. Oh, oh no, he's gonna win. Hey, Leo, Navy Chief.
Navy Pride.
Who's Pride?
Chief is Pride.
Yeah.
All right, Boat Team 5, if you're ready, let's do it.
Let's go, Laxon.
Can you guys see it, Chief?
I can see your desktop.
You had it at first.
Can you guys see it?
Negative, standby.
Now we see it. No, we don't. Now it's gone. It's back. If there's sound, we don't hear sound.
At this point, both team five, do you want to ad lib it a little bit?
Both team five, you there?
I mean, we are here. We're trying to coordinate and be somewhat more organized for this, but our history event was for the Battleship New Jersey. And I'm going to see if I can't get this to play.
Silent but deadly.
Located on our right is the Battleship New Jersey. Designated BB-62, this Iowa-class battleship first rode the waves on December 7th, 1942, 1 year after the attack on Pearl Harbor. The New Jersey quickly made a name for herself through World War II, truly living up to her motto, Firepower for Freedom. Her success made her an obvious choice for the reactivation when the country needed her again, three separate times. She served in World War II, the Korean conflict, the Vietnamese War, and the Lebanese Civil War before she was stricken from the record. During that time, she earned a Navy unit commendation and 19 battle and campaign stars. She is known for being the most decorated battleship ever.
And our video was beautiful. You're just going to have to believe me on that.
You know what? We'll do you one better. Since we have a copy of your video, we'll post it. So if anybody wants to watch it, they can watch it at their own leisure. All right. Sounds good?
Sounds good.
Okay. Due to time constraints, we're going to move forward to the Chargebook Committee. But before we do that, I just want to foot stomp one more time. The Big J Pride project presentation is tomorrow. So if you guys remember, the project is due tonight at 2200. So please give us a good product. Okay. I'm going to turn the floor over to the Chargebook Signing Committee. I know they have some quick instructions before we break out for chargebook signings.
Hey, good evening, everyone. It's Chief Bailey, Special Store Program RDC detailer here at Millington, Tennessee. We're going to go ahead and go on to our respective boat team groups to do the chargebook sessions. Genuines, if you don't remember which team you're a part of, you can go under files under the fantail, and it has the chargebook signing groups broken down by alphabetical letters. So Alpha Bravo, Charlie Delta Echo. We're going to go into each group. Each group will have a boat team will have a moderator in there from the chargebook committee. You're going to go in there. You're going to start off with the selectees, giving a couple minute introduction as to who they are, where they're at, where they come from, things of that sort. And then they're going to impose a question onto the genuines. And then genuines, you take a good 2 minutes, 2 to 5 minutes to give some insight, experience, and way forwards on some of the questions they would have. And if without any further ado, if, unless there's any questions for myself, we can go ahead and split up into the both respective boat teams once you're dismissed by the leads, and we can start from there. Thanks.
Genuines, if you guys have questions, which team you're supposed to go to, I'm here. I can answer them.